he's going to carry out the transformations that would make permanent revolution a reality in countries like Egypt and Tunisia.
Under a gazebo, and we're playing music to people as people came to the demonstration. We had a group called Food Not Bombed that had got food they'd reclaimed from the supermarket that was going to be chucked out the night before they're actually making food for the picketers. And then after the rally, we actually had a few of us charged down with UK Uncut. We weren't an occupied BHS. I mean, this is not a normal trade union demonstration. Absolutely abhorrent and absolutely savage. But there's two things that I've noticed that I think show us the actual sheer the scale of this and how this is actually an ideological attack. This isn't about austerity, this isn't about filling the pockets of the treasury. This is completely ideological. It's two groups of people, two of the most oppressed groups of people that we have anywhere in the world actually, but also here in the UK. And that's firstly women. You look at the attacks that we've got on the sexual health services, the cuts that are being made to sexual health clinics and things that are closing up and down the country. And you actually think, well, actually the effect that this is going to have on the lives of women who aren't going to have access to contraception, aren't going to have access to sexual health services, and the effect that that's going to have. And then you look at some of the other things that happen, sex education, Nadine Dorries. I mean, come on. You've got this woman that's saying that actually women, young girls, aged 30 and up, just girls, are going to be taught about abstinence in schools. You know, this is just completely unacceptable. We've also got you know, this has been trying to push it through Parliament this week, changes to the abortion bill to actually make it compulsory for people to have counselling beforehand. But there's something that's even worse for these things, if you actually think about it. And that's the people that they're actually going to be asking to come in and do that counselling, the people they want to bring into schools to teach children sex education, are actually fundamentalist Christians. And I was talking to one of my friends the other day, he's not particularly political at all, but she was absolutely shaken by this, and she was getting really, really angry at it, and she said one thing to me, she said, who do they think we are? You know, we've been fighting this for years, we thought we'd won these battles, this is a real step back. And she's got a little girl, and she said, do they really think that we're going to stand back and allow priests to tell our daughters what they're going to do with their bodies? We have to fight this. I mean, there's a tax to disability living allowance, which in itself is bad enough, and there's a tax for services that disabled people use. But you only had to watch the news last week when we saw Philip Davis saying it would be good for the economy if we got disabled people to work for less money than able-bodied people. Then that tells you everything you ever needed to know about the Tory. The amount of pain that's going to be caused if services for these vulnerable people are going to be cut is quite clear. When we looked at the abuse that was uncovered at the Winterval care home, a privatised care home where people with special needs were actually being beaten and bullied and victimised. And this is the kind of thing you'll see again and again and again. But what I did notice when I was on the picket lines and on the demonstration on Thursday is that the people that were the angriest, the people that were there in force, the people that were really fighting were women and were the disabled people, and they were right at the forefront. And there's the old adage, isn't there, that the rising of women means the rising of the race, and I think we're actually starting to see that. In Cardiff. We even actually had 150 people in Llandrin Dod Wells in Wales March. You know, if anybody knows Llandrin Dod Wells, that's probably half the population. So, I mean, that was fantastic. But one of the reasons why we think it was such a success in Wales was a very distinct reason. All the way through all of the organisations, through all of the picket lines and all of the leafleting and the agitation, we actually made sure that we had rank and file trade union members involved in every aspect and every level of that. We didn't leave it up to the full-time officers and the bureaucrats. So we made sure that there was a control, and we had a control over what was happening. And I think that's something that's going to be very important as we go into the autumn. I mean, I feel quite lucky to be in PCF, I mean, one of the more militant trade unions. I mean, we still do sometimes have our issues. But I think what we need to remember is that as revolutionaries, what we've done in Wales needs to be put across the rest of the country. I'm sure it was done elsewhere, but what was done for the 30th of June needs to be expressed across the rest of the country and across the other unions. We need to ensure that in the run-up to this, to the run-up to the autumn, that as much pressure as we can possibly put on the trade union bureaucracy is put on the trade union bureaucracy. We've heard brilliant words from people like Dave Prentice and Brendan Barber and other people from the TUC, but we need to make sure that we put the pressure on to make them turn their words into action. And before about the Clyde shipbuilders, when they said that we will work with the bureaucracy whilst they represent us, but we'll work independently of them as soon as they cease to do so, and we need to remember that. And just as we saw, we need to do that here, we saw this in Wisconsin, we saw the fabulous things that happened in Wisconsin, and that was because it was the rank and file trade union activists that actually organised that. And there are some ways that we need to start putting the pressure on. First of all, we need the trade unions to name the day. Now, 12 months ago, people told me that there was, you know, I was mad for saying Walter General strike. But after seeing what happened on Thursday, I think it's very, very, very clear that that is a real possibility. We need to keep that pressure on. And I was going to talk a bit about UK and Cutland being tax collector, but I've just been told I've got 2 minutes, so I'm going to hurry up a bit here. That is that I had the privilege on Friday night of speaking to Kamal, the president of the Real Estate Tax Collectors Union in Egypt. And he said to me one thing, and I was honest enough to speak to him anyway, but he said to me one thing, he said to me, we need to keep in touch. We want to know in Cairo when you're next on strike, because what we want to do is we want to go and then protest outside the British Embassy in Cairo. An awful lot, and sometimes it's a bit wearing to realise, you know, you're out on strike again, you're the only ones fighting, and it's a bit kind of lonely. But on Thursday we were stood there, and other people said this, people, the rank and file activists in the union understood this as well. It wasn't just us on strike, there were other unions, but not just that, it wasn't just that. We knew that there was a general strike in Greece. We knew what was happening in Egypt, we know what's happened in Tunisia and Spain and Wisconsin and many, many other places in the world. And we knew that we weren't alone, and we were really not alone. We're part of the same battle as everybody in all of those countries. And for my political consciousness, from when I was an early teenager, I've been prattling on at people about internationalism, a revolution in socialism, to anybody that would listen. But I cannot tell you how magnificent that feeling was on Thursday to stand there knowing that we were shoulder to shoulder with trade unionists across the globe, fighting together. And there's one thing that we know, and we do know this, and we know that we'll fight, we know we'll keep that pressure on, because we know we need to stay united. Because we know in our hearts, and I'll finish up now, but we know in our hearts that as long as the workers are united, we will never be defeated.